Hello friends, welcome to Engineering Today, and hope you're all having a great day so far. We're back with some interesting updates for you, starting with SpaceX updates, followed by NASA finding a gap in lunar landing after Artemis 3, and ending with Bigelow Airspace. We'll begin with update on SpaceX rocket segment, which will crash into the moon after 7 years of launch. Very soon, a SpaceX rocket will reach the surface of the moon and crash there, and mark SpaceX's footsteps on the moon before Starship can reach there. The SpaceX rocket part, which will do this remarkable event by accident, is practically an out-of-control rocket which SpaceX had flown much earlier in February 2015 from the launch pad of Florida. Recently, some online trackers who keep an eye on space junk movements had forecasted that a 4-ton chunk of a SpaceX rocket is on its way to collide with the moon. They also said that the rocket segment will collide with the moon at a velocity of about 2.58 kilometers per second. Bill Gray, who had made the famous Project Pluto software to track near-Earth objects, asteroids, minor planets, and comets, stated that the SpaceX rocket part will very likely crash near the equator at the far side of the lunar surface by the 4th of March 2022. Gray wrote, "This is the first unintentional case of space junk hitting the moon of which I'm aware. These unpredictable effects are very small, but they will accumulate between now and March 4th. The collision would probably go unobserved from Earth, as Gray says. In essence, this is a free L-cross, except we probably won't see the impact." He also said the bulk of the moon is in the way, and even if it were on the near side, the impact occurs a couple days after new moon. According to earlier sources, the SpaceX rocket was launched to carry out SpaceX's first interplanetary mission. It had deployed National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's, or NOAA's, Deep Space Climate Observatory, and for this the rocket has to cover a journey of about 1 million kilometers before the observatory was deployed. After deployment, the rocket didn't have enough fuel left to make it back to Earth's atmosphere. So it's been following a somewhat chaotic orbit since February 2015. And also spent almost 7 years wandering around space. Now Gray is working to find out the exact time of the crash. He's also alerted the space watchers to have crucial observations of the booster to assist in his calculations. As the crash could not probably be seen from Earth, thus astronomers will depend on images that will be captured by satellites, including NASA's Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, to observe the outcome of the crash. Jonathan McDowell, an astrophysicist at Harvard University, stated that the impact is not a big deal, but still, scientists are hoping to see ejection of subsurface material on the lunar surface, which will get uncovered by crater to be made by the crash. They're also planning to observe the crater for further studies on the composition of lunar regolith. Let's move to the segment related to Artemis lunar landing program. Subsequent to landing astronauts on the moon during the mid-2020s for the first time in half a century, NASA will stand by no less than 2 additional years making a second crewed lunar landing as part of the Artemis program. In introductions at a 2-day meeting at the NASA Advisory Council's Human Exploration and Operations Committee on January 18th and 19th, office authorities said the Artemis 4 mission, the first after the Artemis 3 mission lands astronauts on the moon, won't attempt the landing itself. All things considered, Artemis 4 will be committed to gathering of the Lunar Gateway. The mission will execute the IHAB habitat module created by the European Space Agency and the Japanese Space Organization, JAXA, to the Gateway. It'll be docked with the primary Gateway components, the power and propulsion element, and habitation and logistics outpost, which will launch together on a Falcon Heavy in late 2024 and endure a year spiraling out to the near rectilinear halo orbit around the moon. Artemis 4 will likewise be the solitary flight of the Block 1B version of the Space Launch System, which replaces the interim cryogenic propulsion stage utilized on the initial three SLS launches with the more impressive exploration upper stage. That empowers Artemis missions to convey co-manifested payloads alongside the Orion rocket, for example, the IHAB module. Mark Kirisik, Deputy Associate Administrator and Head of NASA's Advanced Exploration Systems Division, stated during a presentation at the meeting, January 19th, that when you balance the performance constraints against the launch opportunities and get everything to line up, we find that we're awfully challenged. One issue with the mission is the mass of the IHAB. As per Kirisik, co-manifested payloads on the SLS Block 1B have a maximum mass of 10 metric tons, and he proposed IHAB was attempting to get under that cutoff. Kirisik added, Dan Hartman, NASA's Gateway Program Manager, is working with ESA day in and day out to get their mass to meet the limit. One more justification for excluding an arrival on Artemis IV is accessibility of a lunar lander. NASA's Human Landing System (HLS) option, an honor to SpaceX last year, covers just improvement of a lander and solitary maintained trip on Artemis III. NASA will get future arrivals through a different exertion called Lunar Exploration Transportation Services (LETS). The object of LETS is to choose one, and conceivably more, organizations to get feasible landing administration. The timing of LETS, a draft request for proposition is planned for release this spring, implies that there will be an entire 2 or 3 years before the primary arrival administration gained through that program would be prepared. As per Kirisik, it'll be about 2 years from the Option A award to the LETS award before we'll have this sustainable lander. It's a different lander with more aggressive requirements than Option A. We've got a lot of work to do to make Artemis 3, 4, and 5 work with the manifest we have today. We have a list of alternate missions should one of the elements get ahead or behind of the others. Something else would have to change for us to have a lander in the Artemis 4 timeframe. That would make Artemis 5 the principal Artemis mission to both utilize the Gateway and have a lunar landing. That mission, as part of a working manifest diagram introduced at the meeting, will likewise incorporate conveyance of ESA's Esprit refueling and communications module and a Canadian-built rocket arm system for the Gateway, just as an unpressurized lunar rover. Dates for either Artemis 4 or 5 were not included by the manifest, with Artemis 3 planned for mid-2025. In any case, NASA has recently examined its purpose to fly one SLS Orion mission a year, which would mean Artemis 5 would fly no sooner than 2027. As per Amit Kshatriya, Assistant Deputy Associate Administrator for Exploration Systems Development at NASA, at the panel meeting on January 19th, said rollout of the SLS for a wet dress rehearsal, a fueling test and practice countdown at Launch Complex 39B is planned for around February 15th, which would permit the actual test to happen before the finish of February. Kirisik said that after a dissent and claim postponed the beginning of NASA's work with SpaceX on the HLS Option A award, the office is presently engaged with the organization on improvement of the Starship Lunar Lander system. Let's move toward our next segment, where we'll discuss Bigelow Aerospace transferring Beam Space Station module to NASA. NASA has recently hired a new company to provide technical support for the inflatable modules of the International Space Station, which was originally built and managed by Bigelow Aerospace. On January 18th, in a procurement filing, NASA announced that it's awarded a $250,000 contract to ATA Engineering of San Diego, California, to provide technical support services for the Bigelow Expandable Operations, also known as BEAM, an inflatable module added to the station in 2016. The module, built by Bigelow Aerospace, provides support for the module until December. On December 10th, NASA has introduced its motive to award a sole-source agreement with ATA Engineering to address the ONE's engineering services. From that company, one employer said, it was one of the most effective and certified to offer that support given its position as a subcontractor to Bigelow with inside the improvement of Beam and later help of operations of the module, along with engineering analysis that showed the module's life will be prolonged to its past due as 2032. NASA has already announced in the past that Bigelow has transferred ownership and ownership of Beam to the Center NASA Johnson Spaces in December, when the engineering contract expired. NASA spokeswoman Leah Cheshire said, while transferring ownership, one of the conditions was to provide technical support contract that NASA awarded Bigelow in 2017 and was not related to any funding exchange or other agreement between NASA and Bigelow. Established more than 20 years ago, Bigelow Aerospace mastered the development of inflatable module technology and plans to use it for a range of space stations. Apart from Beam, they've launched two more prototypes of inflatable modules, Genesis 1 and 2, in 2006 and 2007, respectively. It's working on a much larger module called B330 because it has volume of 330 cubic meters when fully deployed. Bigelow, on the other hand, declined to participate in a NASA competition to put a commercial module on the ISS, claiming that the agency's money was insufficient to complete its business case. In January 2020, NASA selected Axiom Space to create a commercial module that might be deployed on the station as early as 2024. Bigelow Aerospace laid off their entire workforce in March 2020, blaming state government limitations established in the early weeks of the epidemic that forced the closure of non-essential enterprises. Since then, the corporation has made no public statements about its future plans. It was not one of the interested parties who attended meetings for NASA's private low Earth orbit destinations program last year, which aims to assist the creation of commercial space stations, and it was not one of the three teams that got NASA awards in December. In the future, Beam may not be the sole inflatable module on the ISS. Space Entertainment Enterprise, C, a British firm, said January 20th that it's collaborating with Axiom Space to add an inflatable module to the station's commercial sector. When completely expanded, the C1 module will be a spherical module 6 meters across connecting to a docking port on the station's first commercial module, the Axiom. C stated that the module would be operational in December 2024, which would coincide with the station's addition of the Axiom module. C intends to use the module as a venue for music, cinema, and sporting events. With Axiom Space building this cutting-edge, revolutionary facility, C1 will provide not only the first, but also the highest quality space structure, enabling the expansion of the $2 trillion global entertainment industry into low Earth orbit, said C co-founders Dmitry and Elena Lesnevsky in a statement. Michael Suffredini, president of Axiom Space, issued a statement saying, adding a dedicated entertainment venue to Axiom Station's commercial capabilities in the form of C1 will expand the station's utility as a platform for a global user base and highlight the range of opportunities the new space economy offers. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.